7:28. Should we start? So should we start the class?
Yeah, we are live on YouTube. Just give me a minute, please.
Yeah. Sure.
Right, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Right, so we'll start. Just a minute, right? Yeah, good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 12B, which is the second class in the respiratory pathology. It's not pure respiratory pathology. It is something which deals with respiratory pathology as well. And we are streaming live from Delhi via Kolkata. And the topic of the day is cytopathology of serous effusion, the new reporting guideline. And to talk on that, we have Dr. Akriti Bansal, who's a postgraduate from PGI Chandigarh, a silver medalist. She's presently a proprietor of Sona Med Lab, startup diagnostic and research laboratory in East Delhi, with multiple publications in national and international journal. She is a graduate from Government Medical College, Patiala. Then she did a postgraduate from PGI Chandigarh, in which she had got a silver medal. She's also got very many awards in her name. One of the few ones which I would like to read out is she was recipient of the Nalini Bal Thakkar Award for the best paper presentation in Cytocon 2019. Then she got the KC Basu Malik Award for best paper presentation in APCON 2019. So back-to-back 2019 papers, a wonderful person who has a wonderful, extraordinary knowledge. And her area of interest is serous effusions. So before I ask Dr. Bansal to take over, let me request you to keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Akriti Bansal, ma'am, please share your screen and let us start.
Thank you, sir.
Just press present now.
Yes.
Yeah, that's it. There we are.
Okay, so good evening, everyone. So welcome to the Pursue 12B evening session. Today's topic is cytopathology of serous effusion, the new reporting guidelines. So as we all know, cytopathology in the diagnosis of serous fluid has always been a universally accepted method that has helped in primary diagnosis, staging, or follow-up settings. In the past, the main mode of clinical communication of interpreting the cells was either malignant or not malignant. But the gray area in between was never acknowledged. So, a collaborative effort between the International Academy of Cytology and the American Society for Cytopathology has come up with a new language of communicating the result between the cytopathologist and the clinical team, known as the International System of Reporting of Serous Fluid, abbreviated as TIS. It is done to enhance the consensus, so to reduce reporting variability, to improve efficiency of electronic record data, and also to promote comparison of research results. It consists of 5 diagnostic categories. First, non-diagnostic, the specimen with insufficient cellular elements. Then negative for malignancy, the specimens with cellular changes completely lacking evidence of any malignancy. Atypia of undetermined significance, the specimens that show limited cellular atypia, more pointing towards a benign effusion that we'll discuss later in detail. Suspicious for malignancy, the specimens that show features of malignancy but are not definitely diagnostic of malignancy and the ones that have definitive findings for malignancy. So coming to the first entity, non-diagnostic. So it is the specimen in which no diagnostic information is available, as in the case of the acellular specimen, highly degenerated sample, or hemorrhagic sample. One point to keep in mind is that any specimen that meets the criteria for any other category, even if it is highly degenerated or hemorrhagic, should not be categorized as non-diagnostic, and a diagnosis should be given in that sample if you can make the diagnosis, especially in case of malignancy. So preservation of the sample, preparation of the smear, and staining are very important for the adequacy. Poorly preserved sample results in cellular degeneration, rupture, thick preparation, shear forces during smear preparation, hemolyzed samples, and overstaining and incomplete staining results in poor adequacy of the sample. This is an example. The first photograph shows a hemolyzed sample, a completely hemolyzed sample, whereas in second, we can see a poorly fixed sample. Coming to cellular adequacy, assigning a minimum cell count is not feasible in case of effusion sample, as there would be a different criteria for distinct processes occurring in serous cavity. For example, in the context of tuberculosis, the absence of intact mesothelial cells and presence of only lymphocytes does not make the sample non-diagnostic. So, cellular adequacy is not feasible in serous effusion. Coming to volume adequacy, various studies have shown that a minimum volume of 50 to 75 ml is considered adequate to diminish false negatives and optimize the test sensitivity. The higher the volume, the smaller the number of samples reported as non-diagnostic or atypical. And therefore, clinicians should be encouraged to submit as much of the fluid as possible. Coming to second category, negative for malignancy. When the specimen is composed of only benign or reactive cellular component without any malignant cell, the major benign component in all the serous effusion is first of all mesothelial cell. Mesothelial cells have a well-defined cytoplasmic borders. The cell appear to be surrounded by other cells which show a clasping morphology, and they have binucleation and slit-like separation between the cells because of the presence of microvilli, and these are known as windows. On cytochemistry, they are Alcyon blue positive and have PAS positive granules on the periphery. They are mucicarmin negative, and on ICC, they are positive for calretinin and desmin. Now, these mesothelial cells, they can show a varied morphology. They can show lacy-like edges. They can show false keratinization, which can mimic squamous cell, and you might give a diagnosis of squamous cell carcinoma. There can be cytoplasmic vacuolization, which mimics signet ring cells. So, atypical mesothelial cells should always be reported with caution. Every time you report atypia, keep in mind the clinical details, the background cellular details such as intense inflammation. Never ever interpret a compromised smear, and always keep in mind the conditions in which mesothelial cell hyperplasia is seen, like cirrhosis, uremia, pulmonary infarct. Another component is histiocytes. These are round with well to ill-defined borders, and these are usually single and have a single nuclei. They differ from mesothelial cells in the way that they do not have a window pattern. They generally have a phagocytose material as opposite to the vacuolated cytoplasm of a mesothelial cell. They have a central to peripheral nucleus as opposite to the centric nuclei in the mesothelial cells, and have a kidney-shaped nucleus. Histiocytes can form small, poorly defined clusters that may mimic an epithelial population and can confuse for a metastatic carcinoma in effusions. And sometimes the cytoplasm of histiocytes can also be coarsely vacuolated, giving a signet ring appearance which can lead to a false positive diagnosis of adenocarcinoma. In all these cases, ICC done on the cell blocks can help to confirm the histiocytic nature of these cells. Sometimes our benign effusions are composed predominantly of eosinophils. The cutoff for saying that there are increased or predominantly eosinophils is 10%. Along with eosinophils, chocolate-laden crystals can also be seen. This is generally associated with pneumothorax, hemothorax, allergy, hypersensitivity, or even the presence of parasites. very rarely you can also encounter chiral parasites inside in the effusion fluid. These photographs have been taken from a publication from PGI, in which these filarial worms were found in the ascitic fluid. Effusion fluid can also be composed predominantly of neutrophils in case of empyema or in purulent infusions. And another important and confusing entity is the lymphocyte rich effusion, when your effusion is completely composed of mature lymphocytes. Most of the times in reactive cases, these are T cells. Patient with tuberculosis most commonly present with it. But the problem is that differentiation of a reactive lymphoid proliferation versus lymphoma can be very difficult on morphology, especially if you have to differentiate it from a small cell, indolent, low-grade NHL. And at that time, flow cytometry comes to rescue. Other non-neoplastic conditions that can also be seen are granular necrotic debris as seen in rheumatoid arthritis, LE cells seen in SLE, and reactive mesothelial cells, cell and cell arrangement seen in cirrhosis. In all these cases, clinical history is of utmost importance. Other things like sarcoma bodies associated with endosalpingosis, endometriosis, and mesothelial hyperplasia, and collagen bodies seen in pelvic washings can also be observed. Asbestos bodies seen in asbestosis can also be seen. These are rounded, these are linear structures with rounded ends, which are covered by brown iron salts. And pigmented macrophages can be seen in case of chronic hemorrhagic neurisy or in case of bile spillage in peritoneum. Other non-neoplastic entities can be infectious organisms, like the presence of cryptococcus, nocardia, or actinomyces. So, the features that point towards the diagnosis of negative or malignancy are presence of mesothelial cells as single cells or presence of windows, very rare binucleation, presence of histiocytes, giant cells, lymphocytes, no or minimal cellular atypia, and presence of other benign components such as sarcoma bodies, collagen balls, asbestos bodies, and organisms. Coming to the third and the most important category, that is atypia of undetermined significance. These are the effusions, specimens that lack any quantitative or qualitative cytological features to be confidently diagnosed as either benign or malignant. So, but you have to keep in mind, these are the cases in which you feel that the diagnosis was more likely go towards a benign thing. Okay, but you're not sure of committing it to be benign. You're not sure of signing it as benign. But somewhere you feel that after I've done all the ancillary techniques, the outcome would be benign. So in these cases, there is mild atypia with slightly increased NC ratio. There can be prominent nuclei and there is only slight nuclear membrane irregularity. This complete entity is a diagnosis of exclusion and it should only be reported after you have eliminated any known diseases, any reactive processes due to cirrhosis, ectopic pregnancy, tubo ovarian abscess, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, etc., any bacterial viral infection, or you have excluded the possibility of neoplasia, history of neoplasia. This includes cases such as in which there are artifacts. Now here we can see due to the artifacts, there is degenerative changes in mesothelial cells as well as macrophages. Now this looks like that, okay, this might be just degenerative change and it might be negative for malignancy, but still one is not sure of giving it as clear that negative for malignancy. So for this case, AUS category is described. Now coming to another case, here we can see that we have reactive mesothelial cells, but because of the high proliferation, one cannot very confidently say that it is negative for malignancy. In such cases, ancillary tests are done, but if ancillary tests are itself inconclusive, one has to give a diagnosis of AUS. Another scenario is when you find epithelial cells in effusion, but with bland and benign features. So because they have bland and benign features and there are no malignant features, you cannot put it in a higher category such as SFM or suspicious for malignancy or malignant. But due to the presence of epithelial cell itself, you're keeping it under atypia of undetermined significance. In all these cases, immunocytochemistry and clinical data assist in obtaining a recessive diagnosis. So very important is the approach. Whenever you see small number of cells in a fusion that have mild cytological atypia, first of all, rule out any reactive cause, any relevant clinical history. Once you have ruled out that, okay, there is a significant clinical history, there is some history that points toward reactive causes, diagnose it as negative for malignancy, but write a note of correlate clinically to be on the safer side. If there is no such history, give a preliminary diagnosis of AUS and then perform ICC on it. If on immunocytochemistry, these cells turn out to be just macrophages and mesothelial cells, a final diagnosis of negative for malignancy can be given. But if on ICC, they turn out to be of epithelial origin, it will turn one step higher towards category 4 or 5, depending upon the ICC pattern, whether it is suspicious for malignancy or outright malignant. And very important, if there are insufficient cells or you do not have any facility to do ICC or the ICC turns out to be equivocal, then the final diagnosis of AUS has to be given. So just keep in mind this flowchart by giving a diagnosis of AUS. Coming to category number 4, that is suspicious for malignancy. Now these are the specimen with moderate to severe degree of cytological and architectural abnormality. And in this, you're very confident that, okay, these cells are malignant, but still something, some evidence falls short of confirming it. So in this, the atypical features more closely identified with the malignant features. Okay, so this should be differentiated from AUS. For AUS has mild cytological abnormality, SFM has moderate to severe. In AUS, you generally see dispersed cells with mild atypia, whereas in SFM, you see three-dimensional groups. In AUS, you know that it is preferred when somewhere you're expecting that the outcome of the ancillary test will come as benign, whereas SFM is preferred when you know that ancillary test, you are expecting the ancillary test's outcome to come as malignant. So it is primarily malignant that is short of confidence, and this is primarily benign, short of confidence. Cytological criteria for suspicious for malignancy is cells occurring in large number or small, but limited by artifact. Monomorphic lymphocytic population or atypical lymphoid population in varying number that you're suspecting for lymphoma. Third is presence of mucinous material. Now, this is very important. Whenever you find mucinous material in fusion fluid, either alone or with small number of bland epithelial cells, always reported as suspicious for malignancy, because most of the times it will be due to either a carcinoma of appendix or a mucinous carcinoma of ovary. There is very, very rare chances of a benign process giving the mucinous material in your effusion. So even alone, presence of mucinous material alone, you have to report it as suspicious for malignancy. Mesothelial proliferations that you suspect are for mesothelioma and presence of epithelial cell in peritoneal portions. Immunocytochemistry, flow cytometry, and clinical data assist in obtaining a decisive diagnosis, thereby reducing the rates of SFM. So these are some special scenario. Case 1, in this, the patient had no previous history of malignancy and we had very scant number of atypical cells. And moreover, there was insufficient residual material for performing any immunostains. In such cases, a diagnosis of SFM has to be given. Second case, this patient is a known case of adenocarcinoma colon, and you can see small number of atypical cells in the ascitic fluid cell block. When CK20 was done, it did not show positivity. It may be due to, whenever your immunocytochemistry is equivocal for malignancy, either due to technical reasons or due to an altered immunoprofile of the tumor, and yet the patient is a known case of that particular tumor, a diagnosis of suggestive of malignancy is suspicious for malignancy is preferred. So approach in such cases is that whenever you have a small number of cells that features favor epithelial or any other malignancy, give a preliminary report of suspicious for malignancy. Do ICC. if ICC confirms malignancy, the final report of malignant can be given. But if there are insufficient representative cells or ICC report is equivocal, the final report of SFM will be given. Also, in the centers where you do not have the facility for ICC, final report should be given as suspicious for malignancy and refer for immunocytochemistry. Coming to the fifth category, malignant. Now, these are the specimens with definitive clear-cut findings of malignancy. So, these are divided into two, primary and secondary malignancy, and abbreviated as MAL-P primary and MAL-S secondary. So, coming to malignant primary MAL-P, these generally imply malignant mesothelioma, although there are other malignancies also, but generally mesothelioma we'll be discussing here. So, mesothelioma is the malignant proliferation of serosa cells lining the pleura, peritoneum, pericardium, and tunica vaginalis. Histologically, it tells of four types. However, the above three, that is diffuse malignant mesothelioma, localized mesothelioma, and well-differentiated papillary mesothelioma, most commonly shed their cells into the effusion, and therefore are the top will be discussed today. So, the gross findings in mesothelioma, there will be a large volume of effusion that tend to reoccur, which is amber in color and very viscous, typical honey-like consistency. The main points that point towards the diagnosis that forms a definitive criteria for mesothelioma are supercellularity, that at low magnification, you can see millions of cells. Architectural, there will be cellular spheres, berry-like modules, and nuclear abnormality. So supercellularity along with architectural abnormality along with nuclear abnormality in mesothelial cells forms a definitive criteria for mesothelioma. There are other supportive criteria such as two-tone cytoplasm, large nuclei, prominent nuclei, a wide variation in the cellular size, that is the pleomorphism, numerous multinucleated cells, presence of tissue fragments, pycnotic eosinophilia, presence of perinuclear lipid vacuoles, and pink or red granular background. So here we can see a large variation in the cell size, ranging from very small to very large. We can see perinuclear lipid vacuoles, and we can see that it is highly cellular and papilloroid clusters are there. So the cells of malignant mesothelioma should be differentiated from reactive mesothelium. These are differentiated by the presence of high cellularity, a thick matrix in the background. There would be a wide variation in size, whereas there would be minimal variation in reactive mesothelium. Supercellular smears, presence of and the cellular features such as enlarged cells, presence of macronuclei, presence of innumerable nuclei, and perinuclear fat droplets. Ancillary tests, but still in most of the cases, one has to perform ancillary tests to differentiate reactive mesothelium from mesothelioma. Reactive mesothelium is positive for Desmin, whereas mesothelioma is positive for EMA. Babson is lost in 60% of cases, and there is a homozygous deletion of P16 CDKN2A, which is detected by FISH. So here we can see Desmin positivity in reactive mesothelium and EMA membranous positivity of EMA seen in mesothelioma. The combination of BAPPAN loss by immunocytochemistry and CDKN2A deletion by FISH is the gold standard for differentiating mesothelioma from reactive mesothelium. Another substitute, that is methyl thioadenosine phosphorylase, MTAP, it is a 9P213 related protein that helps in distinguishing malignant mesothelial cells. It has a very high concordance with the 9P21 FISH. So in the facilities where FISH cannot be done, one can go for this ICC. Here we can see the mesothelial cells lack the expression of BAPPAN immunostain, which is a nuclear marker. It is present, it is positive in the surrounding inflammatory cells. The inflammatory cells are internal positive control for BAPPAN. The loss is seen in 55 to 80% of the cases of malignant mesothelioma. Loss of MTAP seen in 80% of cases, which indicates a deletion of 9P21 in the mesothelial cells, showing mesothelioma. So, another important thing is to differentiate malignant mesothelioma from a metastatic carcinoma. the most important point of differentiating a mesothelioma from metastatic carcinoma is the fact that in mesothelioma, there will be a monotonous population because every cell is actually mesothelial cell, right? Whereas in a metastatic carcinoma, there will be a two-cell population. Very, very important point, because there will be mesothelial cells in the background, plus there will be a foreign cell population, right? Alien cell population. So other features, the cellular feature, the metastatic carcinoma, there is a heterogeneous atypia, there the NC ratio is high, whereas in malignant mesothelioma, the NC ratio can be slightly increased because the cytoplasm also increases in case of mesothelioma. Multinucleation can be present, cannot be. Nuclei can be prominent in both cases. Cytoplasm, generally, it is scant to moderate in carcinoma and abundant in mesothelioma. Perinuclear fat droplets are seen in mesothelioma. And mesothelioma generally has a scalloped border. But the most important difference comes, again, with the ancillary technique, that is the immunocytochemistry. Mesothelioma are positive for calretinin, D240, WT1, and CK56. Whereas the metastatic carcinomas are positive for claudin and MOC31, BER-EP4, and the broad spectrum epithelial marker, and P40 and P63. So for making a diagnosis, one should always have two positive mesothelial marker and two negative carcinoma markers. The mesothelial markers preferred are calretinin, WT1, CK56, and D240. Calretinin is one of the most widely used marker. Among epithelial markers, simple cytochemical stains such as PAS with diastase and UC carmine can be used for epithelial mucin. ICC markers such as CEA, BER-EP4, MOC31, MOC4, Claudin-4 can be used. And site-specific markers like TTFN, NAPSIN, PAX-8, CK20-CDX2 can be used and can be included in the initial panel only if there is a particular clinical history. Otherwise, broad spectrum epithelial markers can be used. So here we can see calretinin showing a nuclear membranous pattern giving a fried egg appearance to these mesothelioma cells. WT1 nuclear stain coming positive in the mesothelioma cells. Cytokeratin 6, CK56 showing cytoplasmic pattern in the cells. And D240 highlighting the cell membrane of these mesothelioma cells. So, coming to the next category, that is malignant secondary, MAL-S category. These are the serous effusion specimen, which are diagnostic of a secondary malignancy or a metastatic disease. These are categorized by a foreign population of cells. The cell of origin can be epithelial, neuroendocrine, hematolymphoid, melanocytic, mesenchymaloid germ cell. Now, common source of secondary malignant effusion based upon the serous cavity in male and female are, for pleural, in males it is lung, and in females it is breast. For peritoneal in males, it is GI tract, in females, it is ovary. In for pericardial, it is males, it is lung, and in females, again, it is breast. Vast majority of the malignant effusions are adenocarcinoma. They are categorized by a foreign population of cells that is arranged in papillary clusters, glandular, SNI, or signet ring cells with increased NC ratio, variable pleomorphism, and with presence of mucin, intracellular mucin or extracellular mucin, present as vacuoles. These can be present in various architectural patterns that gives a clue towards the primary site. For example, if they are present in hollow spheres or cannonball, or show a cannonball appearance, they point towards breast carcinoma. Signet ring cells present point towards stomach or breast. Elongated cells towards colorectal cancer. Prominent nuclei towards clear cell or carcinoma of kidney, and small cell cancer, the one that resembles small cell cancer, towards prostate cancer. So, for finding the primary site of malignant effusion, a panel of immunocytochemistry can be applied. These are the commonly used markers for a
Sorry, your voice has just gone away. Hello. No, not at all. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah. Now it's fine.
Okay.
And sorry, I think something went wrong.
Yes.
Please.
Okay.
Please share your screen and start.
Yeah. So, okay, I think my voice went off at the slide.
Yeah, absolutely so, right.
Right. So, for finding out the primary site of malignant effusion, a panel of immunocytochemistry can be done. These are the commonly done immunocytochemistry for these particular sites. Now, coming to this panel, this is a case of primary lung adenocarcinoma. On the LBC smear, we can see a 3D ball-like cluster, which turned out to be TTF1 positive, CK7 positive, and CK56 negative. This is a case of invasive mucinous type of lung adenocarcinoma, showing blebs of mucin in the cytoplasm present as vacuoles. We can see that it was present that it was positive for CK7. This is a case of adenosquamous carcinoma of lung. We can see 3D ball-like clusters in the LBC preparation, which were positive for TTF1, CK7, and CK56. A case of large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma, positive for CD56, and TTF1 was negative. So this is a case of high-grade serous carcinoma of ovary, where we can see papilloid cell clusters as well as some 3D ball-like clusters on LBC, which were positive for CK7, negative for CK20, and showed positivity for Pax8 as well as WD1. Again, a case of metastatic ovarian mucinous adenocarcinoma, where we can see vacuoles of mucin within the cells. Squamous cell carcinoma, they rarely metastasize in diffusion fluid. They are characterized by small clusters or discrete cell population. Oval cells are seen in case of non-keratinizing and polyhedrals are seen in case of keratinizing. They have a dense and orangiophilic cytoplasm with a hyperchromatic nuclei. Here we can see a conventional smear showing singly scattered or small clusters of cells with hyperchromatic nuclei showing CK56 positivity and P63 positivity, confirming the diagnosis of a metastatic squamous cell carcinoma. Pseudomyxoma peritonei, that is a mucinous ascites. We can see thick and gelatinous mucoidy material along with round to columnar cells with very mild nuclear atypia. Generally, it is from mucinous adenocarcinoma of ovary or of appendix. Coming to hematolymphoid malignancies, NHL, non-Hodgkin lymphoma low grade. The main cytological character is that the smear would be highly cellular. At low magnification itself, you would be able to see predominant population of disc cohesive, small to medium sized lymphoid cells. At higher magnification, you can see the nuclear features pertaining to particular cells. For example, you can see soccer ball like chromatin in case of CLL. In all these cases, one has to go for either flow cytometry or a panel of antibodies on the cell blocks. Flow cytometry based antibodies that are suggested in case of low grade NHL are CD3, CD5, CD19, 20, 25, and 23, plus FMC7, kappa lambda. And this will be discussed later in the later part of the presentation. And the suggested IC panel for cell block is 23523 BCL6-2 cyclin B1. So, coming to high-grade NHL, these are also highly cellular preparation with disc-cohesive population of medium to large-sized atypical lymphoid cells. At higher magnifications, certain cytomorphological features can be seen. Like in case of Burkitt lymphoma, one can appreciate the vacuolated cytoplasm. And in case of T-cell ALL or BLL, one can see the variable number of distinct nuclei within the cells. However, for a definitive diagnosis, again, one has to go for a flow or ICC. Coming to plasma cell neoplasia. In this, a predominant population of plasma cells are seen. with a variable degree of ATPR ranging from small, unrecognizable mature plasma cells to completely plasmablastic morphology. Generally, they have a hemorrhagic or necrotic background, and suggested IC panel on cell block preparation consists of CD20, 79A, MUM1, CD138, 38, cyclin B1, CD117, kappa lambda, IgG, ANM. Coming to malignant melanoma. It is uncommon, and it usually presents as discrete cells with variably sized cytoplasmic vacuoles with a large prominent nucleoli. ICC shows positivity for HMB45S100 melanin, and yes, there would be cytoplasmic brown melanin pigmentation, but sometimes this cannot be present. Immunocytochemistry helps in those cases. Very, very rarely, in 3 to 6% of the cases, sarcoma can also show malignant effusion. It is characterized by very scant cellularity. Tumor cells are arranged singly, and there will be variable cellular morphology depending upon the type of sarcoma. The background will be proteinaceous. This is a case of alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma, where we can see numerous discohesive single cells that were positive for Desmin. So this is the preferred reporting format for serous effusion cytopathology specimen. First of all, we have to mention the specimen type, the location, the procedure done. The statement of adequacy is to be mentioned, whether it is satisfactory for evaluation or not. DAIS, diagnostic term, is to be mentioned. One doesn't have to mention the numerical value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but it is better to mention both malignant as well as mal, S or P, both the abbreviated form as well as the complete form. Then comes the notes and comment. The description of the cytological features should be written within the notes, along with the findings of ancillary test, and also any direction for the clinical stuff for the to the clinician. So various studies have compiled statistics to date on the accuracy of and risk of malignancy of various categories through meta-analysis. Non-diagnostic category has a 17% risk of malignancy, as compared to negative for malignancy 21%, AUS with 66%, suspicious for malignancy 82%, and malignant 99%. So overall, this is a practical approach towards a serous effusion. First of all, see whether the effusion is inadequate or adequate. Once you have seen it is adequate, see if there are expected cellular findings like mesothelial cells and inflammatory cells, or there are some unexpected findings. If there are expected findings, you have to see it in regard to the volume and distribution. If you see that mesothelial cells and inflammatory cells are okay and they do not have any ATPR, you can directly give a diagnosis of negative or malignant. If you see that these cells are increased, if predominantly mesothelial cells are present, you can and you find slight ATPR, you can go for ancillary technique before giving it as completely negative for malignancy or mesothelioma after it is proven. If it is histiocytes, most commonly it would be negative. You just have to confirm it by ancillary technique and give it NFM. Predominantly lymphocytes. In case of lymphocytes, you have to perform ancillary technique to rule out lymphoma. In case of eosinophils and neutrophils, you can give a diagnosis of negative for malignancy without any ancillary technique. Now, in cases where you find some unexpected cellular and non-cellular finding, whenever you find a second cell population, it is malignant. It is most likely malignant or suspicious for malignancy, at least. If you can prove it by ICC, first give a preliminary diagnosis for suspicious for malignancy. By proving it by ancillary test, if there are single cells proven by ancillary technique, you can give a diagnosis of melanoma, lymphoma, small clusters, adenocarcinoma, and large clusters. Depending upon whatever the ICC pattern comes, you can give a diagnosis. Presence of these benign structures like sarcoma bodies, collagen balls, asbestos bodies, LE cells, necrosis, spindle, and giant cells, detached ciliary tufts, infectious organisms, point towards the diagnosis of negative for malignancy, but one also has to keep in mind the cellular morphology. In case of infectious organisms, most likely it should go to negative for malignancy, and the cellular ATPR most likely would be reactive. So So this is on a plot in which on the x-axis, increased structural abnormality has been plotted. As we go more towards the right, the structural abnormality increases. And on the y-axis, we have the number of cells. So normally, as we this is the diseased, so here we can see that the number of cells are also more and the structural abnormality is also more. So this is your clear-cut malignant category. This white area, the number of cells are more and there is very less structural abnormality. So this is your clear-cut benign category. But this red area, this is your problem area. This is the domain of atopia, where the number of cells are less, as seen on the y-axis, and the structural abnormality, the cytomorphological features are somewhere in between. So this is the place where our maximum concentration should be. The performance of a cytopathologist actually depends upon the point on the x-axis at which the decision is taken. Like if the person moves more towards the right while taking the decision, there is a less tendency for false positives. Why? Because if we keep our mind of making a diagnosis at this point, we are very sure of the cytomorphological features to be more towards malignant, right? So there are higher chances of higher specificity, less chances of false positives, and a correspond, but it is associated with the less sensitivity. More the cytopathologists move towards the left of this spectrum, we see that there will be a there will be less surety of the structural abnormality. So there is lower specificity, there are higher chances of false positivity, but yes, the sensitivity would be higher. So what does TIS recommend? So TIS recommend to shift the decision point toward the right. So it tells to exclude the morphology wherever you have doubt, to keep it in the AUS category where you feel it is benign and reactive. To confirm this morphology, keep it in SFM and confirm it by ICC, and report malignant where you are fully confident, to decrease the number of false positives and to decrease the number of atypical diagnoses. So TIS proposes to shift the decision towards the right. So by far I have discussed the new reporting guidelines, and now I'll just quickly go through the ancillary techniques that can be used in the effusion samples. Flow cytometry, most commonly used. It is used in lymphocyte-rich effusions to see whether the lymphocytosis is of pure reactive nature or is it an indolent lymphoma. Now, in case of lymphomas, in case of small cell low-grade lymphomas, about 48% of the patients show pleural effusion, and about 10% of the malignant pleural effusions are due to NHL. It is a rapid, reproducible, sensitive, and quantitative method. And the routine panel consists of CD45, CD19, 23, 5, 10, kappa, lambda, and 23. Non-neoplastic reactive effusions have 93% of CD3 positive T cells. So coming to the first case, pleural fluid of an 88-year-old male with a history of lung tuberculosis. We can see numerous small lymphocytes in the sediment of the fluid with practically no mesothelial cells. On flow, we saw that these cells were CD3 positive primarily, about 83%, and there was no lambda or kappa restriction. So this was given as reactive morphology. Coming to B-cell NHL cases, CLL cases generally are light chain restricted, show CD19-20 B-cell population with co-expression of CD5 and 23. Follicular lymphoma will show again CD19-20 with light chain restriction with CD10 positivity, and a demonstration of BCL2, BCL6 expression with rearrangement seen on FISH will help in the diagnosis. Now this is a patient, 83-year-old, pleural effusion sample. Here we can see small to middle-sized monomorphic lymphocytes in the sediment with no mesothelial cells. On immunocytochemical stain, we saw that these were BCL2 positive. On flow, we found that these were CD10 as well as CD19 positive. These were negative for CD23. These were negative for CD23. And there was kappa chain restriction. So this was given as follicular lymphoma. For mantle cell lymphoma, again, there is CD19-20 positive with light chain restriction, with CD5 positive and 23 negative. It should be supplemented by a FISH demonstration of the typical gene rearrangement. For Burkitt lymphoma, we know that effusion occurs in up to 60% of the case. So light chain restriction, CD19-20, 10 positive, and 100% proliferation index as measured by Ki-67-stain. It is confirmed by presence of c-MYC. So this is a cytic fluid of a 52-year-old male patient with a retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. In the sediment, we had normal small to medium-sized lymphocytes. On flow cytometry, we can see that these cells are positive for CD19 with an expression of CD3 as well. It was positive for CD5, negative for CD23. There was lambda restriction, and kappa was negative. On translocation, it was found to be mantle cell lymphoma. And this is a picture of the FISH showing a fusion probe of IGH cyclin D1. Coming to T cell NHL, serous effusions more frequently than B cell neoplasm. TLL are positive for CD2, surface CD3. TDT, CD5, CD10, HLA, DR, and dual CD4, CD8. Hodgkin lymphomas are common. Hodgkin lymphomas, pleural effusions are common in patients with Hodgkin lymphoma. The limitations of flow cytometry. There is no specific or definitive marker of T cells in flow cytometry. Thus, in the case of suspicion, a T cell clonality study is required. In large cell lymphoma of the B cell lineage, risk of false negative diagnosis on flow cytometry can be due to extensive necrosis or mechanical destruction of the fragile cytoplasmic border of the tumor cells, and the CAP-related contamination of body cavity fluid by blood in patients of CLL, which can give a false positive result in the fluid. Second ancillary technique is the predictive immunocytochemistry. With the advent of the targeted therapies and cancer treatment, more and more requirement for testing of molecular alteration is there. Immunocytochemistry is a fast and reliable method for detection of some of these alterations, and it has become even more important after the advent of PD-L1 expression for immune checkpoint inhibitor. So these are the various immunocytochemistry marker. PD-L1 indication is immunotherapy. The ICC is membranous pattern, ALK for tyrosine kinase inhibitor therapy, ROS1 again for TKI therapy, HER2 for anti-ERB therapy, ERPR for hormonal therapy, and MMR for immunotherapy. So this panel I have taken from my own thesis, and this is the cell block from the ascitic fluid specimen, and we can see this is PD-L1, which showed positivity in the tumor cells, and this is the corresponding post-NACT IDA specimen which showed the positivity. In our study, we found that overall concordance in PD-L1 expression between the pre-NACT ascitic fluid and post-NACT specimen was 90.3% in tumor cells. So we concluded that ascitic fluid can be used to evaluate the PD-L1 beforehand. So combined therapy of containing chemotherapy and immunotherapy can be instituted in the patient. This is ALK-ICC in malignant effusion from pulmonary adenocarcinoma. We can see that confirmed ALK rearrangement also shown on using DAB. ROS1 immunocytochemistry showing positivity in the pulmonary adenocarcinoma confirmed with ROS1 rearrangement. Coming to fluorescent in situ hybridization, it can be performed from fluid smears, LBCs, and cell blocks. Various centromeric probes can be used to demonstrate numerical chromosome abnormality for the detection of malignant cells. It helps in detecting the hyperdiploid malignant cells and differentiating the malignant cells from the reactive atypical cells. The common translocations seen in lung adenocarcinoma are EML4 ALK, TPM3 ROS1, and CCD6 and RET. This is the CDKN2A deletion seen in mesothelioma by FISH. These are the reactive mesothelial cells in which we can see all the signals, whereas these are the mesothelioma cells in which there is deletion of this CDKN2A 9P deletion, which results in loss of the yellow signal in these cells. Then RT-PCR, EGFR mutation testing can be done in non-small cell carcinoma. The two most common mutations responsible is the EGFR L858 mutation in exon 21 and in the exon 19, that is 15 base pair mutation, which can be detected by real-time PCR. This is a more sensitive technique, requires less tumor tissue as a testing sample with a sensitivity of 1%, but it detects only known mutations. So this is a case of 56-year-old male with a right lobe lung SOL, which was who was having exon 19 mutation. Coming to IGNOR, a gyrophilic nucleolar organizer region, this is a detection of nucleolar protein by applying silver impregnation method. In the malignant cells, due to rapid proliferation, there is an increased number of large irregular nodes as compared to the reactive mesothelial cells. So by silver impregnation method, we try to detect these cells. So this is a benign effusion. We can see presence of only 1 to 2 dots of IGNOR signals in the benign effusion. Whereas when we compare it to the malignant effusion, there are numerous 4 to 5 IGNOR dots in the malignant cells. The limitations are that it is a very meticulous procedure, and the affinity of the nucleolus for silver stain is so much that it obscures the individual IGNORs. And in case of a small nucleolus, the resolution of individual IGNORs won't be visible. Coming to electron microscopy, it can help in differentiating mesothelioma cells from adenocarcinoma and macrophages. It is rarely done. Generally, mesothelioma cells have long, slender, bushy microvilli, which cover their entire cell surface. And adenocarcinoma has short, stubby microvilli with glycocalycial bodies concentrated at the poles. Macrophages characteristically have folds and ridges on the cell membrane. EM is costly, and adequate tissue for ultrastructural evaluation may not be possible, and turnover time of electron microscopy is quite large. Coming to telomerase activity, the PCR-based telomeric repeat amplification protocol is used to differentiate malignant versus benign pleural effusion. The expression has been shown to be correlated with the telomeric length. This is the PCR-based detection of the telomerase. Here we can see this is the marker. In this, this is the positive control, this is the negative control. Positive control is made by HeLa cell line. And these are the positive cases, and the row 5 show a empyema case, that was a reactive case. And we can see that we do not have a telomerase pattern in it. NGS, it can be performed in cell blocks. Mutations such as EGFR, PIK3CA, and KRAS can be detected. There is high concordance of PCR and NGS in histological specimens. Similar superior DNA quality as formalin fixed in paraffin embedded blocks, and NGS exhibits advantage over qPCR in detecting non-hotspot mutation and providing accurate information for allele sequence and mutation frequency. Other techniques such as tumor cell enrichment, Sanger sequencing, microRNA, and cell-free DNA can also be done by using effusion specimens. Thank you. The main reference for my complete class has been the book International System for Serous Fluid Cytopathology. All the images have been taken from this book, and the rest of the images have been taken from some articles, the reference of which I have mentioned below each slide. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akriti. Wonderful presentation. Can you just stop presenting so that we can see you on screen? We have a lot of people on the YouTube. Let me see if they have any questions. Just please give us a minute. In the meantime, wonderfully presented, and the spectrum has been complete, right from morphology to TRAP to everything. I mean, Agnor also, I don't think so anybody now uses Agnor, but you have completed it. You have talked about it, and you have been talked about TRAP and Sanger sequencing, and everything has been dealt. And a lot of stress nowadays is on flow cytometry, and we are really working on that, and with so many things coming up. And now effusion and now cell block from effusion, and then working on that. That also is a very important thing. But the bottom line is a very, very nice presentation, a very complete presentation, very crisp, very confident, wonderfully done. So nice to have you on this platform.
Thank you, sir.
I don't think so there's any question on the YouTube. Wonderfully done, Dr. Akriti. Thank you so much for taking out time and, you know, teaching us serous effusion. And I know you're an expert in that. You've had medals, you know, in various conferences, APCON, CytoCon, my God. It's back great. So thank you so much. I think we'll have you again with Plura, is it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Great. On 25th of February for mesothelial malignancies.
Mesothelial, so all related, one after the other. Yes. Thank you so much. So nice having you here. Right. So we'll stop here. Bye-bye. Take care. Good night. Bye. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.